Hi, I'm Jeff Engelbrecht. Gas turbines are a topic which is near and dear to my heart, having worked for 30 years in the research and development of these engines. The purpose of this video is to introduce you to gas turbine engines, how they operate, what the advantages and disadvantages are of them, and how they're applied in the world today. In future, I'd like to produce a series of videos that talk about different technical aspects of these engines, and go into more details. So let's start this video off by describing how a gas turbine operates. To provide a visual representation of an idealized typical gas turbine, I produced this simple model, which contains the main features that are in every gas turbine engine. I will not discuss losses in this video, but we'll do this in future videos where we can explore each of the components of the gas turbine in more detail. For visualization purposes, the engine is slowed down. In reality, the rotor would be spinning at a significantly higher speed. Air enters the engine on the left and passes first through the compressor, where the pressure and temperature are increased. Air then enters the combustor, where fuel is added and ignited in a self-sustaining continuous flame. This causes the temperature to rise. A fraction of the air bypasses the flame to cool the combustor and inlet of the turbine, and this air causes the temperature to drop slightly after the flame. The exhaust gases then enter the turbine, where they are expanded and work is extracted to drive the compressor and any other work which is necessary to be driven by the engine. Essentially, the gas turbine works because less power is needed to compress cold air than can be extracted from expanding hot air. So, what is the value of these engines compared to piston engines? One of the main advantages gas turbines have is very high power to weight and volume ratio. This means for the power produced, gas turbines are very light and small. Gas turbines are also very reliable. Compared to piston engines, they have very few moving parts and as a consequence are less susceptible to mechanical failure. Gas turbines also typically do not have external cooling systems like piston engines. Air is bled off the compressor at various stages and used to cool hot components. Gas turbines are also able to burn a wider variety of fuels than piston engines. Combustors, of course, need to be optimized for the fuels they are expected to encounter, but there are many gas turbine combustors that are designed to cope with a range of gaseous and liquid fuels without any need to change hardware. The main disadvantage of these engines is lower fuel efficiency. And this is particularly true for smaller engines. So the smaller the gas turbine, the worse the efficiency, and also for part load operation. However, this can be improved upon if the waste heat from the gas turbine can be used. And an example of that is a modern combined cycle gas turbine power plant utilizes the waste heat from the gas turbine to produce steam, which then drives a steam turbine and produces additional power. And the overall plant efficiency of that is greater than 60%, or can be greater than 60%. And that is very competitive with diesel engines. Okay, so now we know the advantages and disadvantages. How are these engines applied? Well, lightweight, small size, very reliable. These are all important things for aircraft. And indeed, for the last 50 years, gas turbines have been the dominant means of propulsion for both military and civilian aircraft. The earliest jet engines consisted of a gas turbine followed by a nozzle to convert the remaining energy in the exhaust gases into a high-speed jet of air. This engine, known as a turbojet, is still in use today in many military aircraft, like the F-5 Tiger, for example. This concept works very well when speed is important. But for slower civilian aircraft, this concept is very inefficient. The problem relates to the efficiency of the conversion of the energy in the jet of air leaving the engine into propulsive power for the aircraft. This is known as propulsive efficiency. You can see from the equation for propulsive efficiency for an air-breathing engine that this is a function of the ratio of velocity of the jet produced by the engine to the velocity of the aircraft. To visualize this relationship, we can look at a plot of the propulsive efficiency to this ratio. You can see that the closer the velocity of the jet is to the velocity of the aircraft, the higher this efficiency. Thus, to maximize this for slower aircraft, it is important to reduce the velocity of this jet, but to maintain the same thrust, the area of the jet needs to increase as its velocity decreases. To solve this problem, the turbofan engine was developed. The turbine was designed to extract more energy from the flow. On one hand, this reduces the velocity of the jet exiting the gas turbine nozzle because there is less energy in the flow exiting the engine, and on the other hand, provides excess power to drive a large diameter fan, which produces its own low velocity jet. This design works very well for intermediate speed aircraft. For even slower aircraft, the diameter of the fan required for optimal performance becomes so large that the velocity of the fan blades at their outer radius becomes too high, and the performance of the fan is reduced. Typically, the shaft speed for aircraft gas turbines is in the range between 10,000 and 25,000 RPM. You can see that as the diameter of the fan increases for a single shaft turbofan engine, the Mach number of the fan tip quickly reaches 1, and the flow of the tip becomes supersonic. To give a reference on this chart, the GE90 engine, which powers the Boeing 777, has a fan diameter of more than 3 meters. Thus, for such aircraft, it is necessary for the fan to have a lower rotational speed. This has been done in two ways. One, a separate power turbine, designed to run optimally at slower RPM, drives the fan through a concentric shaft, or spool, as shafts are called in aircraft engines. This allows for the fan to run at a lower RPM, however, the RPM is still relatively high. It is common in such designs to split the compressor into two stages and to drive the low-pressure compressor on the same shaft as the fan. Rolls-Royce, on many of their larger engines, even split the turbine into three stages and drive the fan with its own power turbine while the low-pressure compressor is driven by an intermediate pressure turbine. For even lower RPM, a gear is introduced between the gas turbine shaft and the fan shaft. This latter design is known as the geared turbofan engine, and an early example of this can be seen in the Avco Lycoming ALF-502 engines on the Avro RJ-100 aircraft. Modern propeller aircraft driven by gas turbine engines, known as turboprops, and gas turbine powered helicopters also use this geared concept. Gas turbines are also used in a number of applications to produce mechanical power. Because of the high reliability and fuel flexibility of these engines, one of the earliest applications of this was in the production of electricity by directly connecting the shaft of the gas turbine to an electric generator. The speed of the turbine can be designed to operate as a multiple of the frequency of the power being produced. Okay, reliability is easy to understand, but fuel flexibility is a bit more complex. For power plants, one thing that's important is to be able to produce power continuously, so not to have disruptions in the electricity production. And so one way to ensure that is, especially if there is a risk that one fuel might be susceptible to disruption, is to have the gas turbine capable of burning more than one fuel. And typically most gas turbine power plants are designed to be able to cope with both gaseous, so natural gas typically, and a liquid fuel like oil number 2, for instance. The other issue with fuel flexibility is the supply, so the quality of the fuel itself. An example, the United Kingdom, about a quarter of the natural gas that's in the natural gas network there comes from imported sources, liquefied natural gas. And this source comes from different regions. And the quality of the gas from different regions varies. So the hydrocarbon content of the natural gas, and particularly what's important is these higher hydrocarbons because they tend to be more reactive. And so the higher concentration of these, then you run into a risk of flashback within the combustor. Or if the heating value of the fuel goes down, then you have another risk of flame stability. So the flame blowing out or portions of the flame blowing out leading to worse emissions. And so every time one of these tankers comes in with liquefied natural gas and injects it into the network locally, the composition of the fuel changes. And so the gas turbine needs to be able to cope with a variety or a range of natural gas compositions to avoid problems. And so fuel flexibility is very important also in power plants. On top of ground-based power plants, gas turbines, because of their light weight and small size, are also used to produce electricity on board aircraft. Most large commercial aircraft have a small gas turbine, usually in the tail section, called an auxiliary power unit, which produces electricity when the aircraft is on the ground. Additionally, since 1941, gas turbines have been used to produce electricity on hybrid gas turbine electric locomotives. The electricity produced by the gas turbine charges batteries, which are then used to drive electric motors to propel the locomotive down the track. Similar to aircraft engines, gas turbines designed to produce mechanical power often need to do this at a lower RPM. This is achieved similarly either through a separate power turbine or a gear. Examples of engines set up like this include the Chrysler turbine car, which was produced between 1963 and 1964, the Abrams tank, gas turbine powered warships, hydrofoils, hovercrafts, and fast ships, and gas turbine powered gas compressors and oil pumps on oil rigs and along pipelines. So as you can see, gas turbines have a wide range of applications. And of course, with the concerns with CO2 and the environment, these applications will be declining. However, given that gas turbines have a high degree of fuel flexibility, there are proposals to utilize gas turbines to burn hydrogen. And this can be done to store energy, for instance. And I think this is a topic that I'll go into in the next video to discuss how gas turbines are foreseen to be used in the future in a grid dominated by renewables. So this concludes this video. Thanks for watching, and I hope you liked it. If you did like it, please click the like button below. And if you'd like to see more videos like this, please subscribe to the channel. Thanks.